1,650 shots were fired. 379 men, women and children lost their lives. Hundreds of others were injured. The massacre at the Jallianwala Bagh is etched in the memory of each and every Indian as a supreme example of colonial barbarism. Celebrated movies like Gandhi and Rang De Basanti have used this incident as part of their narrative. In the high school textbooks in India, this tragedy is referred to as an important incident in the history of Indian national movement. But was this massacre simply a random act of British barbarism? Or was this saga the culmination of a larger narrative? Or was it the beginning of a new chapter in the Indian national movement?
As we approach the centenary mark of this momentous event, we will try to unmask and unravel the complete story behind the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. This is the story of a city that through its defiance, its attitude, its bravery and its supreme sacrifice led the way to the downfall of the colonial empire in India. This is the story of Amritsar in the year 1919.
The popular perception is that on a call given by the Indian National Congress, people had gathered at Jallianwala Bagh to protest against the Rowlatt Act, and the British troops led by General Reginald Dyer fired indiscriminately at the crowd. But the protests against the Rowlatt Act were going on all over the country. Then why was Amritsar meted out this special barbaric punishment? We start our story on 30th of March 1919. The Congress had called for a general strike all over India to protest against a new law passed by the British government, the Anarchical and Revolutionary Crimes Act 1919, popularly known as the Rowlatt Act.
The bills which they had introduced in the Gazette of India, which were known as the Rowlatt Bills, in fact, there were two bills. The first was designed basically to amend the Indian Penal Code in such a way that it would strengthen the hands or empower the government to check the activities of people who were, according to them, dangerous.
The Rowlatt Act was the continuation of the Defense of India Act passed in 1915 during the First World War. At the time when Europe, Africa and the Middle East were engaged in the Great War, a different movement was gathering momentum on the Pacific coast of the USA and Canada. The proponents of this movement called it Gadar.
Gadar is an Urdu word which means armed protest. And it became a bridge between of understanding between the illiterate peasants and the educated Indians. And it got a focus with the magazine entitled Gadar itself. And it was published in Punjabi Urdu and later in English also. So Ghadar became a movement. From a word of protest, it became a movement.
You might be wondering, what is the connection between Amritsar, Jallianwala Bagh and Ghadar? Well, the connection is vital. And to understand it, we'll have to go to the other part of the globe, the Pacific coast of USA and Canada.
The connection between South Asian pioneers and settlers in the early 1900s to the Ghadar movement is quite a vibrant one. As we know, the settlers first came and settled in the Pacific Northwest, from California to Oregon to Washington to British Columbia. The movement started in Oregon, but quickly spread between all those other states and provinces and established headquarters as well as branches in those areas. The movement was a movement of revolution, of making change, both in India as well as in Canada. And it was a movement of people from all religions and all backgrounds. It was a secular movement. It was something that brought people together.
So I think there's a very distinct connection between the first South Asian pioneers who came to North America and the Ghadar movement. I think it was in part because they didn't realize that they were going to face such hardship and discrimination and racism. Many of them were soldiers, former soldiers as a part of the British Indian Army. And when you read the Ghadar poetry, you read emotionally how much they were impacted by the racism they were facing, and also the unexpected nature of that racism. And so it was this counterbalance between, we're working hard, we're former soldiers as a part of the British Indian Army, and yet we're treated like dogs.
Wake up, O sons of Hind. How long will you stay asleep? You lay in slumber in moonlight. Look, the sun beckons you. Wake. You lay engulfed in the wicked sleep. Whom shall your brethren look to? You wear the Union Jack like a serpent round your neck. Why do you not revive the glory of your saffron and blue emblems? You are happy in your state of gay abandonment. You have lost your wits. You act like fools. Had brave Hari Singh Nalwa been here, he would have replied with the swing of his sword. Had that lion Shivaji been here, he would have laid down his life for honor's sake. Oh ye cowards, you fear death always. Where will you find the courage to fight? Oh India, where are your brave Hindus? Where are the valiant Muslims? Divided we stray and suffer. Why don't we unite and strike together? The oppression, the tyranny we face daily, what stops us from hitting back? The world derides us and calls us coolie. No wonder our flag flutters no more.
The first two decades of 20th century saw a spate of race riots in American and Canadian cities targeting Chinese, Japanese, and the Indian immigrants. But while the governments in Japan and China sympathized with their overseas nationals and negotiated compensation for life and property losses, the British Indian government, on the other hand, made no such effort.
So the race riots that started in Bellingham, and not many people in Vancouver know that history. We often think that the 1907 anti-Asian riots in Vancouver was it. It was the first thing that happened. But in fact, it's a fascinating trajectory because they actually originally started in Bellingham. And what happened there was specifically targeting South Asians, because there was many South Asians working in the Bellingham area. They were physically drawn out of that city. They were physically pushed away and fought and beaten out of that city.
Bellingham at that time had a small group of people working both in the small industries as well as the fishing and agricultural communities. At the same time, while Canada was promulgating all kinds of racist laws, in the US as well, there was discrimination against the South Asians who had settled there. So there was a race riot held in the Bellingham streets by citizens of Bellingham, European-based, who did not like the color of the people that were coming in. The race riots in Bellingham were even more litigious because they actually went into the streets and started to drag people out of businesses and where they lived. The police did come in a little bit late in the system, but when the police did come in, they to save them and to keep them safe, they put them in the prison because there was nowhere to house them for that time.
There is this iconic image of South Asian men being in a jail in Bellingham, and they're all sitting in the ground floor of the jail. And I think the caption reads that they're being protected for their own, they're there for their own protection, because if they're not there sitting in that jail, they could be beaten.
The Indians living in the West realized that unless they overthrow the British government in India and established self-rule, Indians can never attain a respectable position abroad. This resolve was strengthened by the way the passengers of the Kamagatamaru were treated by the Canadian government of the time. On 23rd of May 1914, a Japanese ship by the name of Kamagatamaru came to the shores of Vancouver carrying 376 Indian passengers. These people had all the right to enter Canada, but the racist policies of the government at the time denied them their rights.
So one of the lightning incidences that's happened in British Columbia history, a dark moment, has been the Kamagatamaru incident, where a ship load of people who came to settle in British Columbia were turned away. The ship stood in the waters of Burrard Inlet for 2 months.
Of course, in that historical moment when it was happening in 1914, people didn't realize how big this moment was. People didn't realize what Gurdit Singh was trying to do when he was challenging the racism, the legislated racism.
I think it was a bit of a shock to them that as British subjects, that they could be discriminated to this level. They had, a false sense of security that the British were a benign government and that they would support them in these movements of people and mobility of people. And this also, the Kamagatamaru incident also sharpened the pro-nationalist movement back home as well as here. So it did nothing to dull it.
After a 2-month-long standoff, the ship was forced out of Canadian waters.
And so that became kind of that catalyst moment where they kind of ruptured themselves from the British imperialism rhetoric and that rhetoric of serving for the empire. That was that moment where they ruptured themselves and said, no longer. We're not going to do this anymore. We are going to fight for our independence, the independence of India at that moment. And it was fascinating because it was done within the diaspora. It was done here in Canada and North America and the United States. That was where they created the materials. They created the pamphlets. They had the freedom at some level to be able to do that, where perhaps in India they wouldn't have had that necessary freedom because everything was so censored.
So the larger thrust of the Gadar members was to get the British to stop ruling India and to give back India to its natural citizens.
Between 1914 and 1918, an estimated 8,000 Indians left the USA and Canada to fight against the British. But although the revolutionaries were armed with the spirit of freedom and sacrifice, they did not have the resources to wage the war against the mighty British Empire. 45 Gadarites either died at the hands of police or were sentenced to death. 17 were sent to the cellular jail in the Andaman Island. 53 were subjected to various degrees of incarceration and torture for the rest of their respective lives. The Gadar Party had Stanford professors like Hardayal, students from University of California like Kartar Singh Saraba and Vishnu Ganesh Pingle, former members of the British Army like Harnam Singh Kala Sangha, a farmer from the village near Amritsar, Son Singh Pakna, and Indians from all walks of life, of all castes and classes. While the Gadar Party was making the preparations in the USA and Canada to launch Gadar, on the other side of the globe, in India, the British were seeking the support of the Congress to recruit Indian soldiers to fight in the First World War.
The other thing that was fascinating was the same moment that the Kamagatamaru ship is being denied access, those passengers are being denied access. So the ship is going back to Calcutta. Soldiers, as a part of the British Indian Army, are being shipped off for World War I and serving the British imperial interests. So it's this amazing kind of contradiction between we are being forced essentially to serve for you, yet we are being denied something that is our given right.
In addition to these seasoned, hardened soldiers who had been serving for the Raj, you had a large number of people who were recruited. These were the new recruits. And by the time the war ended, it was a large number that had joined the army. So we had the Indian soldiers and non-combatants almost to the point of 1.7 million.
After 1857, the revolt of 1857, they had a policy and they had floated this idea that you are martial classes, you know. So from Punjab, they termed the Sikhs as a martial class. So that's how Punjab gets affected. Of course, the peasantry as it is, you know, economically, they weren't so well off. Nothing was helping them out with all these epidemics of all types of diseases like, you know, cholera and plague, you know, in the area. So they were ready to, you know, sort of make a living for themselves. But interestingly, you know, they were paid very less and neither was the status given to them. But they were simply recruited in the army for the benefit of the British.
Now, these soldiers are non-combatants who went to war may not necessarily have gone to fight for the king. Many did. But many others, they joined because of economic reasons.
So recruitment in the beginning, of course, was done with the help of the civil authorities. So this is how they were recruiting men to the army. But, you know, in the middle of the year 1917, they are short of these recruits. So what the government did was they started recruitment boards, recruiting boards. They set up at the central as well as in the provincial level. And even at the district level.
If we look at the number of soldiers who fought in the war, we find that about close to 72 to 74,000 Indian soldiers died during the First World War in all these theatres. And another 60 to 65,000 were wounded. So overall, our casualties were close to about 130,000 soldiers, and which is a large number.
But when the war ended, the British government ignored the sacrifices made by the Indian troops and instead used the activities of the Gadarites to impose the Rowlatt Act. The popular catchphrase to describe the act was Na Appeal, Na Vakil, Na Daleel. No appeal, no lawyer, and no arguments. The Rowlatt Act would give the British unchecked power to curb all the voices against them. To protest against the Rowlatt Act, the Congress gave a call for a nationwide strike on March 30th, 1919. Mahatma Gandhi postponed the date to April 6th. The Amritsar Congress Committee, however, decided that they will go ahead with the proposed strike on March 30th. And this is where this city assumed the role of a leader in the Indian national movement. Amritsar observed a complete strike or hartal on March 30th. About 30,000 people gathered for a rally at the Jallianwala Bagh. This rally was led by Dr. Saifuddin Kichlu. When the news of this strike reached the governor of Punjab, Michael O'Dwyer, he summoned the deputy commissioner of Amritsar, Miles Irving, and told him to make sure that there is no strike in Amritsar on April 6th.
Miles Irving had a mole in Amritsar Congress Committee. His name was Hansraj. At the behest of Miles, Hansraj tried to convince the Congress that they should not go ahead with the proposed nationwide strike on April 6th. His argument was that since Amritsar is a city of businessmen and traders, They would not like to shut down their businesses so often. Dr. Satpal and Dr. Kichlu were aware of Hansraj's affiliation with the deputy commissioner. In order to fool the government, they first agreed to postpone the strike, and later on, at a meeting held on April 5th, they decided that they will go ahead with the nationwide strike call given by Mahatma Gandhi on April 6th. The strike on April 6th was even more successful than the one on March 30th. Once again, a protest rally was organized at the Jallianwala Bagh. Thousands of people gathered at the venue. Miles Irving realized that he had completely lost control over the city. Irving confided in Odwyer that the local leaders from Amritsar, Dr. Satyapal and Dr. Kichlu, can start a whole new revolution in India. While the Indian National Congress was still in a mood to negotiate with the British within the parameters of the British law, Amritsar posed a threat to the very existence of the British Empire in India. This fear was not unfounded. 2 days after the strike on April 6th, Amritsar sent yet another strong message to the government. This time, the citizens of Amritsar decided that they will set an example for the whole country to emulate as to how India can counter the British policy of divide and rule.
And out of all the public processions and activities undertaken by the people of Amritsar was a Ram Navami procession, which was held on the 9th of April of 1919. Ram Navami is specifically a Hindu festival observed in the memory of God Ram. On that day, on 9th of April, a procession was certainly observed in Amritsar, but it was also a kind of a statement projecting the unity of all the people of Amritsar. When I say this kind of it, I mean the people belonging to all the religions, be that be Hindus or Sikhs or even Muslims also. Earlier, the practice was to have different kinds of water placed on public places for Hindus and Muslims, known as Hindu water and Muslim water. On that day, Hindus and Sikhs and Muslims drank from same pitcher. And in that procession, the most spectacular thing was that even Muslims participated in that.
I'm standing here in front of Bada Mandir in Katra Aluwali, Amritsar. It is from this place that the Ram Navami procession on April 9th, 1919 started. This Hindu procession was led by a Muslim, Dr. Hafiz Bashir.
But it is very clear that during that procession, people of Amritsar in a way rose unitedly, rising above any kind of any common divisions.
The solidarity and unity shown by different communities during the Ram Navami procession sent shivers down the spine of the administration. On 10th of April, the deputy commissioner deployed armed forces at all the important sites in Amritsar. The same day, he called Satpal and Saifuddin Kichlu to his house for consultations, but instead, he arrested them and sent them to Dharamsala, a town 200 kilometers from Amritsar.
Miles Irving had thought that without the leadership of Dr. Satpal and Dr. Kichlu, this sudden surge in the patriotic fervor of the city will fizzle away. But he had underestimated the strength and spirit of this millennia-old city. The news of Dr. Satpal and Dr. Kichlu's arrest spread like wildfire, despite Miles' strenuous effort to keep it a secret. And the moment the news reached the population of the city came to an abrupt halt.
Immediately after Dr. Satyapal and Dr. Kichlu were arrested and sent to Dharamshala, when that procession was organized by the citizen Amritsar, when it reached the railway carriage, that it was faced or confronted by a force of police and military. By that time, martial law was not there. But at that time, two advocates tried to mediate between the demonstrators and the police and army. Those were, one was Sardar Gulbakhsh Silaria, the second was possibly Maqbool Mahmood. These two advocates mediated, but they didn't succeed. So the demonstration was fired upon, and in that firing, the police claimed that 10 people were killed, but people claimed that 20 to 30 people were killed. A number of demonstrators were injured also.
जलियांवाले बाग के ताल्लुक से जो हालात बने, भंडारीपुर पर जो जुलूस गया, उस जुलूस पर जो गोलियां चलाई और उन गोलियों के उसमें तकरीबन 20 आदमी मारे गए, उन सब लोगों को जामा मस्जिद खैरुद्दीन लाया गया। यहां पर एक कुआं हुआ करता था मस्जिद में, अब भी उसके वो जगह बाकी है। उस कुएं पर उनको नहलाया गया और इहतजाज में उनकी लाशों को काफी देर तक रखा गया और फिर अपने अपने हिसाब से फिर उन लाशों को कफना करके अपने जगह पर ले जाया गया।
Those who escaped the bullets, they reached Hal Bazaar. Rioting and arson ensued. The crowd attacked the National Bank and ransacked it. They killed the manager Stewart and assistant manager Scott. Then the crowd set the bank on fire. The violence continued for more than an hour, and three more British officials were killed by the mob. The mob did not spare the European women either. Miss Sherwood, a school inspector, was attacked in a lane called Kucha Korya. She was saved by the intervention of some local Congress leaders, but she suffered serious injuries. Next day, on April 11th, General Dyer was sent to Amritsar with clear-cut instruction from the Governor Michael O'Dwyer that he should teach the people of Amritsar a lesson. Although the signed document from the Governor putting Amritsar under martial law had not yet reached the Deputy Commissioner, General Dyer assumed the charge of the city nevertheless.
This is what we are going to do. There will be no sale of third-class railway tickets. I don't want anyone from nearby areas to come to Amritsar. No processions, no public meetings. The city will be under curfew after 8 p.m. If anyone is seen outside after 8, kill him. No questions asked. Shoot and shoot to kill. No one will leave Amritsar without my permission and cut off all water supply and electricity for a week. And first thing tomorrow morning, I want to visit the street where Miss Sherwood was attacked.
On April 12th, after a visit to the site where the attack on Miss Sherwood took place, General Dyer issued an order that prohibited the citizens from walking in that lane. If anyone had to walk through that lane, he or she will have to crawl on their belly till they reach the end of the lane. This order applied equally to men, women and children.
ਸਾਡੇ ਬਜ਼ੁਰਗ ਦੱਸਦੇ ਸੀਗੇ ਇੱਥੇ ਮਤਲਬ ਕਿ ਉਸ ਟਾਈਮ ਦੇ ਉੱਤੇ ਚਿਟਕਟੀ ਲੱਗ ਗਈ ਸੀਗੀ ਅਤੇ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਅੰਗਰੇਜ਼ਾਂ ਨੇ ਉੱਥੋਂ ਲੰਮੇ ਪਾ ਕੇ ਲੰਘਦੇ ਸੀ ਅਤੇ ਕੋੜੇ ਮਾਰਦੇ ਜਾਂਦੇ ਸੀ।
ਲੇਟਰ ਦੈਟ ਈਵਨਿੰਗ ਡਾਇਰ ਚੌਕਡ ਆਊਟ ਅ ਸਟ੍ਰੈਟਜੀ ਟੂ ਟੀਚ ਦ ਪੀਪਲ ਆਫ ਅੰਮ੍ਰਿਤਸਰ ਅ ਲੈਸਨ। He asked for a map of the city and jotted a route on the map. Next day, on April 13th, Dyer would go around the market route and warn people not to participate in any political rally. But he intentionally covered only a small segment of the city. A large part of the city, as well as neighboring villages, were unaware that Dyer had forbidden political rallies and had issued shoot-at-sight orders. 13th of April 1919, Baisakhi Day. Thousands of devotees came to pay obeisance at the Golden Temple. Most of the Congress leaders were behind bars.
Another significant thing of that period is the participation of common people on their own. In a way, they were taking the initiative in their own hands, in a way. One example is of Ballu Halwai. He was a commoner of Amritsar, and He was doing a simple kind of work here. And interestingly, it was this fellow who went through the streets and bazaars of Amritsar on 12th of April, announcing the meeting to be held at 4 o'clock on 13th of April in Jallianwala Bagh. Now this shows one thing, that in that scenario, it were not only the leading public figures who were seen to be active in those kinds of activities, but it was the common people like Ballu Hulwai, for example, who came on his own to keep one kind of tin pipa in his hands and going through the bazaars and streets of Amritsar announcing that meeting.
A local leader, Kanhaiya Lal, was picked up by Hansraj to lead the protest. By 4 p.m., about 25,000 people had gathered at the Jallianwala Bagh, covering most of its 7-acre space. At 4:15, Dyer inspected a parade of his troops, and then he began his journey from the historic Gobindgarh Fort to the Jallianwala Bagh, a distance of about 5 kilometers. His convoy included 2 armored vehicles with mounted machine guns, 50 foot soldiers from Gurkha and Baloch battalions who were armed with Lee Enfield rifles. 40 more Gurkhas marched along the caravan armed with khukris. Owing to the crowded streets in the city, Dyer's caravan moved slowly, and it was 5 minutes past 5 when he managed to reach the gate of the Jallianwala Bagh. The entrance was too narrow for the armored cars to go in, so Dyer could not use the machine gun on the crowd. At 5:15, Dyer's troops had positioned themselves facing the crowd, and without issuing any warning or giving the people a chance to leave the venue, Dyer ordered his troops to open fire. For the next 10 minutes, Dyer's troops continued to fire upon the protesters. Dyer ordered his troops to fire in the direction wherever the crowd was thickest. Many people jumped into this well to save themselves from the bullet, but not many of them survived. 1,650 rounds were fired. Only 150 failed to hit the mark. 379 people died. These are the official figures. The casualty estimates made by the Indian National Congress put the number of dead at more than 1,000. After the massacre, Dyer and his troops left the venue. He did not make any efforts to provide medical assistance to the injured.
Another important fact which we normally talk about, the cruelty of 13th of April, then the most interesting testimony is neither of a police official, nor of a government official, nor of a leading public figure, but the testimony of a commoner, the testimony of a woman with the name Ratan Dey. Ratan Dey's husband was killed on that day in that firing. When she came to know about death of his her husband on that evening, she went there. At 8 o'clock, the curfew was to begin. Nobody else was ready to venture out of his own home during that curfew. So Ratan Dey stayed in Jallianwala Bagh through the night, having only stick in her hand to shoo away the dogs, the jackals, away from her husband's body. It is she, in a way, who witnessed the macabre scene on that night. She remained there. It was she who, in a way, deposed before the fact-finding commission constituted by the Congress Committee. It's her testimony which tells her about the cruelties on that day.
ਤੇ ਉਹ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਸੀ ਕਿ 1919 ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਮੈਂ ਤੇ ਸੁੰਦਰ ਸਿੰਘ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਸਾਡੇ ਤਾਇਆ ਜੀ ਸੀ ਉਹ ਅਸੀਂ ਜਲਸਾ ਸੁਣਨ ਗਏ ਸਾਂ ਅਤੇ ਉਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਜਗਦਮ ਗੋਲੀ ਚੱਲ ਪਈ ਅਤੇ ਇਸ ਕਰਕੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਫਿਰ ਭੱਜੇ ਅਤੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਉਹਦੀ ਲਾਸ਼ ਨਹੀਂ ਚੁੱਕ ਸਕੇ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਗੋਲੀ ਵੱਜ ਗਈ ਸੀ ਅਤੇ ਜਦੋਂ ਗੋਲੀ ਵੱਜ ਗਈ ਸੀ ਮੈਂ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਉਠਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਸਕਿਆ ਅਤੇ ਆਪ ਕੰਧ ਪਾਰ ਕਰਕੇ ਕੰਧ ਹੀ ਸੀ ਫਿਰ ਆਲਾ ਦੁਆਲਾ ਖੁੱਲ੍ਹਾ ਸੀ ਅਤੇ ਉਹਦੇ 'ਚ ਫਿਰ ਨਿਕਲ ਆਇਆ ਦੋ ਦਿਨ ਬਾਅਦ ਜਾ ਕੇ ਉਹਦੀ ਲਾਸ਼ ਲੱਭ ਕੇ ਲਿਆਂਦੀ ਜਿੱਥੇ ਮੈਂ ਡਿੱਗੀ ਸੀ ਉੱਥੇ ਜਾ ਕੇ ਪਈ ਜੀ ਹੋਰ ਵੀ ਕਈ ਲਾਸ਼ਾਂ ਹੈਗੀਆਂ ਸੀ ਲੋਕ ਲੱਭਦੇ ਪਏ
The governor of Punjab, Michael O'Dwyer, applauded Dyer's action. Winston Churchill described the massacre as an extraordinary event, a monstrous event, an event which stands in singular and sinister isolation. Nobel laureate Rabindranath Tagore, who had been knighted by the British, returned his knighthood as a mark of protest against this atrocity. The British government launched an inquiry into the incident under a committee headed by Sir William Hunter.
General Dyer exceeded the reasonable requirements of the case and showed a misconception of his duty, which resulted in a lamentable loss of life. Although we are constrained to this decision, we are convinced that General Dyer acted honestly in the belief that he was doing what was right, and we think that in the result, his action at the time checked the spread of the disturbances to an extent which it is difficult now to estimate.
After the inquiry, Dyer was relieved of his duties and sent back to England. No punishment was recommended for him. General Dyer received a hero's welcome when he returned to London. He was hailed as the saviour of Punjab and was honoured with a sword and £26,000. This money was collected through a fund started by the newspaper, The Morning Post. This convinced Gandhi that the time for negotiation with the British under the British laws was an exercise in futility. He returned his Kesare Hind gold medal. From this point onwards, the Congress would demand for the complete independence of India from the British rule. If the massacre at the Jallianwala Bagh gave a new direction to Gandhi and the Congress, it also fostered the revolutionary thought that wanted to overthrow the British using violent means. Udham Singh, the 18-year-old young man from Amritsar who survived the massacre, made it his life's purpose to seek revenge. On March 13, 1940, 21 years after the tragedy, he assassinated Michael O'Dwyer at the Caxton Hall in London.
The sacrifice of one city inspired two parallel movements aimed at the independence of India. The non-violent satyagraha led by Mahatma Gandhi and the violent armed resistance led by the likes of Bhagat Singh and Chandrasekhar Azad. For the first time since 1857, Indians started to believe that the British can and must leave India. And in less than 30 years after this tragedy, the British packed their bags and left India.
The tragedy of Jallianwala Bagh in 1919 is a shameful scar on British Indian history. As Her Majesty the Queen said before visiting Jallianwala Bagh in 1997, it is a distressing example of our past history with India. We deeply regret what happened and the suffering caused.